Good morning, everyone. Good to see you all here with us on a rainy Sunday morning. We are glad that you're here. For those of you that heard the sound effect, we have no idea where that came from. So that's interesting. Hopefully that doesn't happen repeatedly throughout the service today. It's the government. Yep, they're we don't know. It could be all of the above. So if that happens, you know what we're going to do? We're going to smile and laugh and keep going. And it's all we can do. But it's a good thing we're starting with a happy song. So you go ahead and stand. We're going to sing together. There's within my heart a melody. Jesus whispers sweet and low. The chorus says that he keeps me singing as I go. There's within my heart a melody, Jesus whispers sweet and low. Fear not, I am with thee, peace be still, in all of life's ebb and flow. Jesus, 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 sweetest name I know, fills my every longing, keeps me singing as I go. All my life was wrecked by sin and strife. Discord filled my heart with pain. Jesus swept across the broken strings, stirred the slumbering chords again. Jesus, 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 sweetest name I know, fills my every longing, keeps me singing as I go. Soon he's coming back to welcome me, far beyond the starry sky. I shall wing my flight to worlds unknown, I shall reign with him on high. Jesus, 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 sweetest name I know, fills my every longing, keeps me singing as I go. Amen. Good singing. You can be seated.
All right. Good to see everybody this morning. Appreciate you being here. And that's a pretty good crowd for a rainy day for Baptist. All right. And if you're watching today, I estimate 600 or something like that. Well, maybe not that many. But anyway, we're glad that you're here today. And trust the service is going to be a blessing to you today. And just a couple announcements. If you brought your offering this morning, you can put it in the offering box there in the back. Thank you, thank you, thank you to everybody that brought candy. And we appreciate that very much. If you forgot yours, you can still get in, all right? If you'll call the office tomorrow, and you can make arrangements maybe to drop that off, and but we can sure use it. And if you can help, of course, Trunk or Treat's this coming Saturday. But if you can help, we don't need a lot of help now because we're doing the drive-through. But if you would be willing to help, you can just see Brother John. And we do need some watch team guys, probably about 3 or 4 watch team guys to help us with the traffic. And so if you can help see Brother John also. And then the elections are coming up. What, 10 days to election, something like that? We're going to need a little bit of help for elections, and we kind of do that in shifts. So if you can help with that, if you'll see, also you can see Brother John, we can put you on the list, and we appreciate it so very, very much. If you have not heard already, our dear sister in Christ, Shirley Hall, made her earthly flight. Looking at that song this morning, made her earthly flight. To not worlds unknown, she knew where she was going. And about 8 o'clock this morning, Shirley crossed over. And God gave her great grace and great peace these last few days. I just want you to know that her family was able to be there and be able to have some time with her. And I told them this morning when we were over there, I said, do you realize how good God's been to you of allowing her to be here at the house, her home? That's where she wanted to be. But I hope you'll pray for her and pray for her family as well. And we'll let you know when arrangements are made. We'll be meeting with them this afternoon. But speaking of that, if you brought some dishes, I think all of them are plastic Tupperware type. They sent those back yesterday. And if you want those back, they're over in the kitchen. And we can open that up for you and let you get those. If you don't want them back, you can just leave them over there and we'll put them in the kitchen and use them somewhere. But they are over there, and if you want to pick those up. And then also, Ronnie Blanton, Brenda's brother, it's just a matter of time. And we expect a call just any time now, telling us about his home going. And so if you'll pray for the family as well. Jack and Mary, I talked to Brother Jack. I talked to him about every other day. And Brother Jack has been cleared. In fact, he got his clearance, and Jack got in the car and took off, all right? He was at the commissary when I talked to him Friday, I believe it was. Yesterday I talked to him. And he is doing well. Of course, he misses Mary. And she is, they're looking maybe to move her to rehab for some time. But if you'll pray for that and pray that they're going to be able to get her weaned off the oxygen and her breathing the oxygen on her own. But if you'll pray for them. And then we pray for Shannon and her family. Shannon and her great uncle, Boat Barefoot. And his real name was Eldridge, but his name was Boat. And you say, how did he get the word boat? We don't know. He's just always been called that. But he went home to be with the Lord. And they'll have that service, I think. When is that service? Tomorrow. In Dunn, at the cemetery in Dunn. And so if you will pray for that family. Sad. But happy that today is the McKinnis, Matt and Jamie and the boys, there last Sunday with us. But they start a new time in their life. They're going to Florida. Somebody's got to do it. I know. Somebody's going to Florida. And they've already sold their house, got a house down there. And this is their last Sunday. And we're going to miss them. But remember, we never say goodbye, right? We just say, see you later. And so I hope you'll be able to give them a fist bump or an elbow bump or whatever after the service. But we have enjoyed you all being with us so, so very much. And, you know, you think we'd get used to this in military town. Nah, it doesn't, you know. But we just know that's God's will through the military to move you all down there. So we're going to pray for you all. And we've enjoyed your ministry and your fellowship while you all been here. And we're glad to have Floyd and Samuel with us today. And you're looking around and you're saying, good night, Samuel's moved back. No, he hasn't moved back. No. He's visiting today and come up here to get a few things. But we told you he's got a place in Easley, South Carolina, near Greenville. So we want to pray for him. Good to have them with us today and in the service. Always good to see them. But we're glad to see you today. Let's bow and pray together. Father, we come today thanking you for the blessings and goodness of life. Thank you, Father, that even though it's raining outside and dreary, we're glad that we can sing this morning. We're glad, Father, that you give us a song in our heart. And Lord, we do pray. We're thankful for the life of Shirley. And Lord, how she loved this church and how she loved the ladies of this church and how they ministered to her in these days of food and cards and calls. And Lord, we were blessed to be able to have her. And we thank you for her home going. We thank you, Father, that her earthly pilgrimage is over. And now she's in the land of the no more. No more pain, no more sorrow, no more suffering, and no more death. And so our prayers would be today for Jerry and Sherry and Jan and the family, that you would minister to their hearts during this very, very difficult time for them. But we thank you for them and also for Shannon's family. And we pray for them today. Pray for the McKinnis. Lord, would you bless them, give them safety as they travel. All their furniture is going to get there, and they're going to get set up in their new home. We thank you for them. Thank you for the time we've had to get to know them and be blessed by them. But we ask your blessings on the service today. Lord, speak into our life and through your word, we pray in Jesus' name. And all God's people said, amen. Amen. Amen.
I want to say one more time, I mentioned this after Jamie sang the last time, but how much we appreciated Jamie and the music ministry and the choir and the special music, and certainly miss her voice here in the church. And thank you, Jamie, for all your singing. And then Matt, I remember very clearly the day when he came forward and gave his life to Christ right here in this auditorium. And what a joy it has been to be a part of that and to see that family be here so faithful. So love you folks. We're going to miss y'all. Anyway, we're going to have our scripture reading now, Psalm 47. If you are able to, if you would stand and turn with us to Psalm 47, we're going to be reading from the whole psalm together, and we'll be reading from the King James Version if you'd like to follow along. Now, this is one of the psalms that employs a good bit of military-type language. You remember David started out as a shepherd, so some of his psalms have a lot of shepherd language in them. And then later on, he was a warrior and a king, and some of his psalms have some warrior language in them. And it was just David writing from his life experience and expressing in the way that he knew about God's greatness. So we can certainly understand that. Even though we may not be doing battle on the battlefield with swords and with enemies, we can understand David's heart. So we're going to read this great psalm together now. We'll make a note. Verse number 2 says that the Lord is terrible. Terrible in the Bible language did not have the negative connotation it has now. When we say something's terrible, like broccoli's terrible or whatever, it's negative. But it does mean inspiring fear or demanding reverence. And so that's what it means about God. God is, when you consider God and you gaze upon the Lord's glory, it does inspire fear and reverence in your heart. And so that is what he is talking about, but not in a negative sense. All right, so we'll begin Psalm 47. We're going to say the reference. We're going to read the psalm together. Lord willing, we're going to say the reference at the end as well. Let's read together. Psalm 47. Oh, clap your hands, all ye people. Shout unto God with the voice of triumph, for the Lord Most High is terrible. He is a great king over all the earth. He shall subdue the people under us and the nations under our feet. He shall choose our inheritance for us, the excellency of Jacob, whom he loved, Selah. God is gone up with a shout, the Lord with the sound of a trumpet. Sing praises to God, sing praises. Sing praises unto our King, sing praises. For God is the King of all the earth. Sing ye praises with understanding. God reigneth over the heathen. God sitteth upon the throne of his holiness. The princes of the people are gathered together, even the people of the God of Abraham. For the shields of the earth belong unto God. He is greatly exalted. Psalm 47. Amen. Great imagery there of God as he fights with his people. He steps onto the battlefield with a shout of victory. He carries the shields of his people. Great imagery there. And that was the cause for which David was praising him in this scenario. What is the reason that you are able to praise God today? What has he done in your life that would inspire you to lift a song of praise to him? We're going to praise his name today with a couple of songs, beginning with this one. As morning dawns and evening fades, he inspires songs of praise.
As morning dawns and evening fades, you inspire songs of praise that rise from earth to touch your heart and glorify your name. Your name is a strong and mighty tower. Your name is a shelter like no other. Your name, let the nation sing it louder, 'cause nothing has the power to save but your name. G- Jesus, in your name we pray. Come and fill our hearts today. Lord, give us strength to live for you and glorify your name. Your name is a strong and mighty tower. Your name is a shelter like no other. Your name, let the nation sing it louder, 'cause nothing has the power to save. Your name is a strong and mighty tower. Your name is a shelter like no other. Your name, let the nation sing it louder, 'cause nothing has the power to save but your name. 'Cause nothing has the power to save but your name.
Amen. He does have a mighty, great name. Amen. The only name under heaven given among men whereby we must be saved. And if you can't praise the Lord for just that reason alone, then I don't know what to tell you. But he has a great name, and we sing his praises. That's why we gather together, is to lift up his name.
I sing praises to your name, O Lord. Praises to your name, O Lord. For your name is great and greatly to be praised. I sing praises to your name, O Lord. Praises to your name, O Lord. For your name is great and greatly to be praised. I give glory to your name, O Lord. Glory to your name, O Lord. For your name is great and greatly to be praised. I give glory to your name, O Lord. Glory to your name, O Lord. For your name is great and greatly to be praised.
One more time on I Sing Praises.
I sing praises to your name, O Lord. Praises to your name, O Lord. For your name is great and greatly to be praised. I sing praises to your name, O Lord. Praises to your name, O Lord. For your name is great and greatly to be praised. For your name is great and greatly to be praised.
Amen. You can be seated. Wonderful singing, church. Thank you for joining us in a song. Speaking of songs, we have prevailed upon Brother Floyd to sing a song today. So Brother Floyd's going to come and he's going to sing. He actually rescued me. I got swapped in last minute for somebody who was supposed to sing and wasn't here. So as soon as I saw Floyd, I fell on my knees and said, Floyd, would you sing? No, that's not true, actually. But we are glad for Brother Floyd to be here. Brother Floyd, you come sing for us.
Truth is, I had to pay him. Truth is, I had to pay him a lot to be able to sing today. Now, listen to the words. I know you hear that a lot, but listen to the words, because if I were God, I would look down at me and I would say, that guy's a lost cause. Push him aside. I got better things to do. Right? But he died for me. And even if I mess up, he forgives me and lifts me back up. He mends my heart, and he gave his life for mine. His heart was broken, mine was mended. He became sin, now I am clean. The cross he carried for my burden. The nails that held him set me free. His life for mine, his life for mine. How could it ever be that he would die? Son would die to save a wretch like me. One love divine, he gave his life for mine. His scars of suffering brought me healing. He spilled his blood to fill my soul. His crown of thorns made me royalty. His sorrow gave me joy untold. His life for mine, his life for mine. How could it ever be that he would die? God's Son would die to save a wretch. Stripped of his garment and oppressed, I am loved and accepted, and I wear a robe of righteousness. His life for mine, his life for mine.
Good job, Floyd. We have been on a journey of life together, and God's been good to us, and just blessed by that song today, and blessed by you all being here. Take your Bibles, turn to 3 John. It's in the New Testament, and you go racing back toward Revelation, and right before you get to Jude, put your brakes on, because you're there. If you get to Jude, turn around a little bit, put it in reverse. And 3 John, because I'm going to speak to you today on big things do come in small packages, and that the truth is worth walking in. We're going to have a Bible quiz in a minute, all right? This is going to determine how soon you get out today, all right? So if you want to look through your table of contents, memorize all the books of the Bible, do a quick Bible, whatever, and... Children's church. I am sorry. I got to say all that again? No, no. Kids can go to children's church. All right. I wonder if y'all was waving your hands and Kathy was pointing to Frank, and I thought, what's Frank? Is it his birthday or whatever? I can't. Then Frank's pointing up here, and now I'm confused. Then we got to start all over again. No, we don't. No, we don't. No, we don't. Did I say we're having a Bible quiz? All right. Did I say you're not getting out until everybody gets it right? All right. Here we go. Bible quiz is coming in now. Had you ever noticed, I know you have, particularly around Christmas and birthdays, that it's kind of always the biggest or the bigger packages that seem to get our most attention? It doesn't matter if you're a child or an adult, all right? Adults, you got to admit it, all right? You look at that great big box, and that's the one you want to open first. And there's a lot of little ones down there, but you want to open that big one. But you have to admit, sometimes you tear that big one open, and it's a coat. But in the little box is maybe a diamond ring or a video game or something like that. You know, of all the packages around the tree or on the table around the birthday cake, the biggest one is the one we kind of admire, we shake, and we want to open first. Sometimes we're pleasantly surprised, right? And sometimes, even though we don't want people to see it, we are greatly disappointed. I guess it's part of our nature, maybe, that today we have, everything today is bigger. Today we have extra large, humongous-sized burgers, quarter-pounders, half-pounders, 5-pound burgers, and so on and so forth. We have super-sized fries, you know, mega-guzzler drinks that they advertise. But don't forget, big things can and do come in small packages. Now, even though this is not a reference to that, it's kind of ironic that Zechariah, in Zechariah chapter 4, verse number 10, says, "For who hath despised the day of small things?" All right? So you got to be careful. You got to be careful that you don't look for the bigger. In Matthew 5, 18, "For verily I say unto you, till heaven and earth pass, one jot or one tittle shall in no wise pass from the law, till all be fulfilled." So even Jesus himself said, whoa, wait a minute. You know, don't get captivated by, you know, the big scriptures and the ones well known, that heaven and earth are not going to pass away in one jot or one tittle until all of it is fulfilled. All right, here's the quiz, all right? Here's the quiz. Let's test your knowledge. And I will tell you, this is an Old Testament question, all right? I'm going to mention a name. Don't just raise your hand if you know. This name I'm going to mention in the Bible, he had a title. He had a certain responsibility that he was known for. If I mention the name Tola, who would know who Tola is in the Bible? Anybody? John does. I figure John did because he read my notes. No? No, he didn't. No, he didn't. Tola. All right. So nobody, just John. All right, how about, let me give you another hint. Same title, same responsibility, Abdon. We're going to be here a long time, folks. We're going to be here a long time. Anybody at home got that? Nope, nobody at home's got it either. All right, here's another one. All right, you're going to get it on this one, Ibzan. Nope, none whatsoever. All right, just here's one more hint. I'm going to give you a name, and Samson was a what? A judge, yeah. So along with these other guys, how many of the judges, how many of them were women? One. Her name was? Deborah. Yeah, Deborah. All right, good. So there was 11, 12 judges. There's, you know, it's according to who you read after. Some say 12 judges. Some say 11. Some say that Eli, the priest, and Samuel, the prophet, and Samuel's sons were also leaders in that respect. We don't know. Many Bible scholars believe Barak was a judge. But so John saved you all. All right. So we're going to get out at least by 1 o'clock today. All right. By 1 o'clock. But you understand this, you know this. In your Bible, the books of the Bible are broken down, even though not in the front page of your Bible. They're broken down into different classifications or categories according to their content. Now, they do that to help us kind of realize what's in those books or those group of books. Like in the Old Testament, Genesis through Deuteronomy is known as the what? The Pentateuch or the Law or the Torah, five books of Moses, all right? Joshua through Esther is, we classify kind of the books of history that tell us the history of Israel. Job through the Song of Solomon are the poetical books or wisdom books. Isaiah through Daniel are prophetical, and they are called the major prophets. Hosea through Malachi are known as the what? The minor prophets. Yeah, you are doing good. We may get out quarter to one, maybe, something like that. But now remember, the designation major and minor has nothing to do with the information or the importance or the content. They are ranked like that or are said to be the minor prophets because of their size. All right? You get in the New Testament. Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John are known as the Gospels. Yeah, yeah. Acts is a church history, tells us history of the church. Romans through Hebrews is Paul's letters that he wrote. James through Jude are general letters that we have. And there's different classifications. And then Revelation is known as Apocalypse, or it means an uncovering. Talks about the final destruction of the world. But in the Old Testament and New Testament, there occurs five books that are referenced as the shortest books of the Bible. One is in the Old Testament. Four are in the New Testament. But all of them have one chapter. Again, they're given this designation because of their length, not because of their information, importance, or content. And sometimes we may tend to look over these when we're reading our Bible or studying our Bible. But these shortest books have a lot of information and a lot of encouragement and a lot of challenge for us today. Now, in your King James Bible, those five are listed as 3 John has 294 words or thereabouts. There's some that have maybe a few more, a few less or whatever. Don't count them during the service, all right? 3 John is the shortest book, all right? And that's what we're going to look at this morning. 2 John has 298 words. And then Philemon, which we studied a couple of weeks ago, has 430 words. And then Jude has 608 words. And Obadiah, the one that's in the Old Testament, has 669 words, all right? It's interesting when we're thinking about the Bible, and think about reading and studying and meditating on the Bible. In Psalm 119, of course, Psalm 119 is David's love for, appreciation for, the encouragement he receives from the Bible. And he says in Psalm 119, verse 17 through 20, "Deal bountifully with thy servant that I may live, and keep thy word." Verse 18, he says, "Open thou mine eyes, that I may behold wondrous things out of thy law. I am a stranger in the earth. Hide not thy commandments from me." And then he says, "My soul breaketh for the longing that it hath unto thy judgments at all times." And basically what David says, I want to know more. I want to know more about your commandments, your statutes, and so on and so forth. So the longest book of the Bible has 42,704 words. It has 150 chapters, and that would be the book of Psalms, yeah. Jeremiah is right behind it. Jeremiah has 42,654 words and has how many chapters? 52 chapters, yeah. Now we've already studied one of those short books, as I said, Philemon. So we're going to take kind of a survey through these, and we're not maybe going to do one each Sunday. We're going to kind of intersperse them throughout these weeks ahead. And so today we're going to look at 3 John, 294 words, or the shortest that we have as far as chapters, the books of the Bible. 3 John is probably the most personal of John's three letters, or John's three epistles, all right? He wrote 1 John. It was a general letter that he addressed to the congregations that were scattered throughout Asia Minor. 2 John, that we're going to look at next, was a letter that he wrote evidently to a certain lady and her family. And then some say it was actually not a lady, but it was actually to the church, all right? And we'll look at that a little bit later on. But 3 John, there's no mistake when we read and study 3 John, John gives us a name of who he's writing to. And he's writing to the well-beloved Gaius. Now, of course, it was written by the Apostle John. He was one of the 12. He was the youngest of the apostles. He was the son of Zebedee and Salome, and his brother was, of course, James, who was also one of the 12. John is credited with writing the Gospel of John, and then also the three epistles of John, and also the book of Revelation. John Maxwell says, as he thinks about these three Johns, 1 John is about God's life, 2 John is about God's truth, 3 John is about God's way. So 3 John is about personalities, and the theme of this is truth. In fact, a lot of John's writings, in 1 John 10 times he mentions the word truth. In 2 John he mentions it 5 times. In 3 John he mentions it 6 times. So let's look at this. Let's look at 3 John, if you will. You read along with me as we read this together. And then we'll kind of break it down and look at these three characters that he is mentioning here. Verse number 1, the elder unto the well-beloved Gaius, whom I love in the truth. Beloved, I wish above all things that thou mayest prosper and be in health, even as thy soul prospereth. For I rejoiced greatly when the brethren came and testified of the truth that is in thee, even as thou walkest in the truth. I have no greater joy than to hear that my children walk in truth. Beloved, thou doest well, thou doest faithfully whatsoever thou doest to the brethren and to strangers, which have borne witness of thy charity before the church, whom if thou bring forward on their journey after a godly sort, thou shalt do well. Because that for his name's sake they went forth, taking nothing of the Gentiles. We therefore ought to receive such, that we might be fellow helpers to the truth. I wrote unto the church, but Diotrephes, who loveth to have the preeminence among them, receiveth us not. Wherefore, if I come, I will remember his deeds which he doeth, prating against us with malicious words, and not content wherewith, neither doth he himself receive the brethren, and forbiddeth them that would, and cast them out of the church. Beloved, follow not that which is evil, but that which is good. He that doeth good is of God, but he that doeth evil hath not seen God. Demetrius hath good report of all men, and of the truth itself. Yea, we also bear record, and you know that our record is true. I had many things to write, but I will not with pen and ink write unto thee. But I trust I shall shortly see thee, and we shall speak face to face. Peace be to thee. Our friends salute thee. Greet the friends by name. So if there's kind of two verses in 3 John that ought to really speak to us, it's verse number 4. I have no greater joy, John says, than to hear my children walk in truth. Now that's true of us personally as parents. It's personally true of us in a family. We ought to be glad. We ought to be glad when we see younger people. We ought to be glad that people in our family are walking in the truth. And then verse 11, Beloved, follow not that which is evil, but that which is good. He that doeth good is of God, but he that doeth not, that doeth evil, hath not seen God. I was studying this last night, looking back over my notes, and I was thinking, when the things that are happening in our current culture, I just kind of wrote this down. How many believe that character counts? How many believe that integrity and honesty count in places of leadership? Oh, I surely do. Now, they may not count to anybody else, but I tell you what, when I begin to look at somebody or I begin to view somebody, character is a big deal. Honesty is a big deal. Integrity is a big deal. So in 1 John, John is writing and saying the truth is worth living for. In 2 John, John will say that the truth is worth standing for. And here in 3 John, he's saying that the truth is worth walking in. He says, I have no greater joy than to hear that my children walk in truth. Now, of course, you notice that he mentions three men here in 3 John. So let's look at those, because that's what comprises this book here. And each of these shortest books that we're looking at is kind of contained in itself. In other words, we can study one, miss a couple of Sundays, and come back and study another one, and we won't miss anything. But three men are mentioned here. Verses 1 through 8, he mentions Gaius. And Gaius was a faithful follower of Jesus Christ. No doubt that we read that. Verses 9 through 11, Diotrephes. It's evident who Diotrephes was. He loved to have the preeminence. And then verse number 12, one verse, Demetrius. Demetrius had a good report of all men and of the truth. Let's look back again and look at verses 1 through 8. And let's look at Gaius. He writes, the elder unto the well-beloved Gaius, whom I love in the truth. Beloved, I wish above all things that thou mayest prosper and be in health, even as thy soul prospereth. For I rejoiced greatly when the brethren came and testified of the truth that is in thee, even as thou walkest in the truth. I have no greater joy than to hear that my children walk in truth. Beloved, thou doest faithfully whatsoever thou doest to the brethren and to strangers, which have borne witness of thy charity before the church, he's commending, whom if thou bring forward on their journey after a goodly sort, thou shalt do well. Because that for his name's sake they went forth, taking nothing of the Gentiles. We therefore ought to receive such that we might be fellow helpers of the truth. Now Gaius was a fairly common name in the Bible. In fact, it's mentioned about five other times in the New Testament. And you can kind of Google that and it'll tell you Acts 19, Acts 20, Romans 16, 1 Corinthians chapter 1. So what do we know about Gaius? All right, so eight verses here are given to this man by the name of Gaius. And this is all that we know about him. But we know enough to know that Gaius was a good guy. He was the kind of guy that you would like to have as a friend. He would be the kind of guy you'd like to stay in his home. That's what John is commending him for. So what do we know about Gaius? Well, we know from verse number 1 that he was a dear friend of John's. He says there that unto the elder unto the well-beloved Gaius. And then he says, whom I love in the truth. So just those two verses, we know that Gaius was a dear, dear friend of John's. Verse number 2, we know he was a spiritually healthy believer. Verse number 3, he tells us he was steadfast. He walked faithfully in the truth. And then verses 5 and 6, he was a selfless servant who was known for his hospitality. I mean, people, when you mention Gaius's name, people automatically, oh, yeah, yeah, yeah. And you know what? He opens up his home and he entertains the brethren and these missionaries that are traveling, and we'll mention those in just a moment. And his faith was evidenced in his actions. Not only did he talk the talk, but he walked the walk. So Gaius, we know Gaius was a good guy. He was a guy that you would want to emulate his characteristics. You would want to emulate because he was a man of character. You would want to emulate because he was a man of honesty. All right, let's move on. In verses 9 through 11, three verses, we read about a man by the name of Diotrephes who, John says, loved to have the preeminence. He loved to put himself first. And it's evident as we read, as John says, I'm going to straighten him out when I come, but I just want to let you know about this guy. He liked to be the center of attention. Sad to say, there are people in the church even today. And you may know somebody. I don't think we've ever had anybody here, but you may know somebody. And they're known for, hey, they want the spotlight on them. They want their name on the marquee out front. All right, if they do something, they want to be known for it. They want their name in the bulletin. In fact, Diotrephes, all the pictures in his wallet were of himself. All right? All the pictures in his wallet. Well, now, wait a minute. Wallet. Some of you don't understand. On your phone, all right? If you got his iPhone and you looked, every picture would have been of him or something he had done. All right? So you kind of get an idea about Diotrephes. He's not the kind of guy you want to hang around. All right? You don't want him to rub off on you. All right? J. Vernon McGee says, evil deeds are an expression of false doctrine. All right? Evil deeds are an expression of false doctrine. Now, verses 9 and 10, it seems that John had written a previous letter to the church, but Diotrephes maybe evidently had intercepted it and never read it because he rejected John's authority. Why? Because he wanted to have the preeminence. He didn't want anybody above him. But notice in verse number 1, John makes it clear as he writes this letter, he's writing this and saying, the elder. That means not only age, but his office as an apostle. He wanted to state that. And Paul did that a lot of times in his writings. As he was trying to defend those critics of him, he wanted them to know who he was. And so I don't think John's boasting here. He just wants to set the playing field here. He said, I want you to know I'm an elder. I'm an apostle. But Diotrephes loved to have the recognition and the attention and be the center of attraction. So just in these three verses, what things do we know about Diotrephes that we want to say, I don't want to be like that. I don't want to be known for that. Notice he was a dictator. He had to rule or to ruin, my way or no way, you know. He was a dictator. His sin was, it's easy, he was prideful. He had an inflated ego. You know, it's kind of interesting that people like this kind of charge through life. They kind of charge through life and, you know, they think, boy, everybody looks at me and they don't know how people are talking about them on Facebook and what people really think about them. I mean, they had probably figured this out before John writes this, that Diotrephes, hey, listen, he stirs up trouble in the church. He had to occupy the leading place. He refused to receive John. Why? Because John, again, was an elder and had authority over him. He made malicious statements about John. And he refused to entertain missionaries or the brethren. Now, J. Vernon McGee says this, the missionaries in the early church were itinerants. In other words, they traveled from place to place, all right? Not like travel today, all right? The local inns back in those days, and they did have inns, places to stay for people that were traveling, and not like Holiday Inn Express, not like anything, you know, Hampton Inns or anything. These places that people stayed were wretched and dirty and full of corruption. A lot of things took place. In other words, they were a place where you ever stayed in a place you had to keep one eye open all night long? Well, these places you had to keep both eyes open, all right? So what would happen, they would entertain, they would be entertained, excuse me, they would be entertained or kept in the homes of believers. So you imagine today, you know, you're sitting around and, you know, an itinerant missionary, an itinerant preacher, a brethren comes through and they might just show up at the door. And we read about this in the Bible. They might just show up and say, hey, you got a place for me to stay tonight. Or you may hear that they're in town and you may say, listen, hey, you're welcome to come and stay with us. All right, so you kind of get the idea. But he refused to do this. And so we also learn he kicked those out of the church who did. This guy was a tyrant. I mean, they probably could not wait till the next business meeting to say, get rid of this guy, all right? Verse number 11. It says, beloved, follow not that which is evil, but that which is good. He that doeth good is of God, but he that doeth evil hath not seen God. Don't let this guy fool you. Don't let this guy fool you, he's saying. So he's saying right is right, wrong is wrong. 1 Timothy 6:11. The Bible tells us we're to follow after righteousness. You and I are to follow after righteousness. Someone said, sometimes the simplest test for determining who to follow is just to examine their life. Isn't that true? I mean, that counts for me, but sometimes the simplest test is to look at a person's life, what they say, how they act, and just to say, hey, I don't want to follow him. I don't want my kids around this kind of person. So we have Gaius. You think about the contrast. Gaius focused on serving others. I mean, Gaius, his home was always open. There were always people there staying, coming and going. And Diotrephes focused on himself, serving himself. And then one verse, you think about one verse, John is writing here. And in verse number 12, he mentions, before he closes this short letter, he mentions Demetrius. Look at verse number 12. Demetrius hath good report of all men and of the truth itself. Yea, we also bear record, and you know that our record is true. So he had a good reputation. He held to the truth. So what do we know about him? Well, we know his name was kind of a common name also, Acts 19, two times there. But it's interesting that F.B. Hall says, and he was an evangelist teacher, wrote commentaries 1874 and 1964. He wrote this, and I thought it was very, very interesting. He says, it is not that he bore witness to the truth, listen to this, but that the truth bore witness to him. Demetrius was not the standard by which truth was tested. The truth was the standard by which he was tested, and having been so tested, he stood approved. So in one verse, we know a lot about this guy by the name of Demetrius. He embraced the doctrine of Christ. People gave testimony to his character. In other words, if you would mention Demetrius, oh yeah, you know what? That guy is a good Christian brother. I tell you what. His walk is straight. He just, anything he says. And then if you mention, you know, Diotrephes, whoa, wait a minute. He stood true to what he believed. But then also he practiced what he believed. Like Gaius, he not only talked the talk, but he walked the walk. So what do we have? What do we learn here? Well, we know that during the first century, Christianity was on trial. It is today. It's always been on trial. But during the first century, Christianity is new. The death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus Christ is not that old. It's still fresh on everybody's mind. And so as it's spreading, then the gainsayers and the false teachers, and they flock, and you know, they were saying, we got to stop this. This little spark that began to burn is now a wildfire. You think about the wildfires in California. We got to put this out. And so they were trying their best to stamp out Christianity. But the apostles had three main responsibilities. Number one, to establish, present, and pass on the truth as they had received it from Jesus Christ. To declare the gospel. All right? That was their primary responsibility. 2 Timothy 2:1-2. Thou therefore, my son, be strong in the grace that is in Christ Jesus. And the things that thou hast heard of me among many witnesses, the same commit thou to faithful men who shall be able to teach others also. All right, so that is a church today. Our responsibility, what, is to pass on what Jesus Christ taught, to pass on the gospel. Secondly, they were to encourage those who were walking in the truth. That's what John is doing here. He's encouraging Gaius. He's encouraging others about them walking in the truth. He said, "Dearly beloved, I have no greater joy than to hear my children are walking in the truth." And then thirdly, they were, and we see this here, they were to expose and rebuke false teaching and doctrine. So we have in this short letter that we tend to maybe pass by. Maybe we've read it before and we maybe just really didn't notice these three men here. But we have in this short letter the story of three men. Two were genuine. Two were the real deal. You know what? The church needs more people like Gaius and Demetrius, who were willing. They were willing to faithfully and consistently serve the Lord. They were willing to be a good testimony of God's grace, and they were not concerned about who got the credit. They didn't know. They didn't know that God in His wisdom and John under the inspiration of the Holy Spirit, as he writes this letter, their names were going to be read hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of years later by thousands and thousands of people, and that we were actually going to proclaim them and give honor to them today. They didn't know that. If you would have told them, if John would have said, "Listen, I mentioned you, is it all right if we put this in a Bible and people are going to," they'd say, no, please don't. Please don't do that. We just serve the Lord. We're happy serving the Lord. And praise the Lord that folks in Layton Chapel Baptist Church have lived their life this way. Have lived their life this way. Have not got their name on the church sign. Not got their name in the bulletin. Have just quietly passed through. And they just served the Lord. Been a good testimony. And then one was a fake and a phony. He didn't have people fooled. Spurgeon says of this, of a man who will not do well in his present place because he longs to be higher is already too high and should be put lower. I thought that was good. Diotrephes was self-seeking. He never learned to distinguish between the love for Christ and a love for his place in the church. So today we give honor, even though they'd say, no, please. We give honor to these two men today. And we give honor. Last Sunday we celebrated our 85th anniversary, 1935 to 2020. And I mentioned this last Sunday, but you didn't. Today we give honor from that day when those group of people stood on the porch over there and took the picture. There might have been some said, no, we don't want on this. Come on. Homer, George, come on, get up here. And they reluctantly got up there and had their picture taken. We don't know what they did. I'm sure there were some teachers there, Sunday school deacons. Maybe those folks that just faithfully witnessed. Alina Godfrey was in that picture as a little girl. And we had the joy of being able to have her in our church. She was the church historian until the Lord took her home. I always, when I visited with her, I wanted her to tell me about the church, and she told me some things about the church. I wish I'd have written them down. But you think about the hundreds since that picture was taken. And you're part of it. You're part of it. The hundreds of unnamed and unknown people that have come to this church. Some have prayed. I mentioned Shirley. Shirley loved this church. She loved her Sunday school class. And she often told me, I pray for you. I pray for the church. There were hundreds of people that taught, Sunday school teachers. Think about Miss Reese and her teaching over there in the old building. And others, I won't mention a lot of names. And the preachers that have preached through these years. The people that have served, cut the grass, cleaned the buildings. The people that have given so this church continue. And then there were people that were just encouragers. Thank God for people like that that just serve and work. And thank God for you today. As you read and study this, it's an encouragement because, you know what? I want my life to emulate these two guys right here. When I'm going, I want people to be able to say some good things about me. I want the Lord to get credit for everything. But I'm sure that's your desire today. So we give honor to these two guys today because John gives honor to them. Let's bow and pray together. Father, we come today thanking you for your blessings and goodness. And Lord, two unknown guys in the Bible that John mentions that emulated character, integrity, honesty, a love for the brethren. And Lord, I believe it's our desire, every one of us, not only those here, but those who are watching at home, members of our church, maybe members of another church. We want to be like that. We want to be that kind of church member. We want to be that kind of Christian. And Father, we realize along the way there are going to be those that want to have the preeminence. And so, Father, help us. Help us as John will exhort us here and also in his other writings. Help us to walk in the truth every day. Help us to walk in the truth every day. And Lord, as we close our service with an invitation song, I pray that we might use this to give our lives over to you again. And if there's somebody watching, somebody here that's never trusted Christ, received Christ as their Savior, that they would fall upon your grace today and believe on the Lord Jesus Christ. And the Bible says, thou shalt be saved. Have your will and way in our lives and hearts as we wait before you. We pray in Jesus' name. Bethany's going to play through an invitation song. Let's wait before him just for a few moments. Amen. Be careful going home. Have a good rest of the afternoon. Pray for Shirley and her family. And we'll see you Wednesday night, Lord willing, hopefully. You are dismissed. God bless you.